guess it's officially good afternoon. Thank you very much for coming today. I'm John Espenshade. I'm the political action chair for the NAACP and the secretary for the Coalition for Education and Economic Security. And I want to just first of all express my appreciation to you for being here. I want to also introduce to you other members of CEES. If your CEES people are here in the audience, stand up. These are some of our members, including our vice president. I want to also ask, are there members of the executive committee of the NAACP that are here today? And if so, would you please stand? Thank you very much. And anyone that's a member of the NAACP, please stand. All right, terrific, terrific. And anyone that's concerned about education and our children in Halifax County, please stand. Now, I'm not going to introduce to you our attorneys that are representing us in this case. Although they are some pretty fine country lawyers from San Francisco, Washington, D.C., and Chapel Hill, and they asked us, they said, you guys want us there when you talk about this case? And we said, well, we've got it. We're counting on you in the courtroom. You'll like them when you get to meet them. The issues in this case, now let me just give you sort of, first of all, format for what we're going to do. You're going to hear from the chair this morning of the Coalition for Education and Economic Security, Rebecca Copeland. I think probably has the longest tenure as a woman representing an advocacy group in Halifax County. You're going to hear from David Harvey. Mr. Harvey is the president of the Halifax County branch of the NAACP. And you're going to hear from Dr. Reverend William Barber, who is the president of the mighty North Carolina NAACP Conference of Branches. That's a long title to get out. And then after that, if we have time, and we want to try to wrap up by 1 o'clock, but at the end of that, we'll give you a chance to ask questions of any of the speakers that are here. And for members of the press, we hope that there'll be short, limited opportunities right after the press conference if you want to talk to any of the people here that are here today. There's one other person I'm going to ask to stand who is one of the plaintiffs in this case who has children in the school system. Ms. Silver, if you'd please stand, please. Thank you. Appreciate your courage and your participation in this effort. Okay, so that's the format. Just a brief word, and then I'm going to turn this over to our speakers. This 38-page indictment boils down to three issues. Are our children in Halifax County getting a sound basic education in the three public school systems? Number one. Number two, is that system of three separate, racially segregated public school systems, unequally financed in Halifax County, is that working for our children? And number three, the county commissioners are the only administrative body in Halifax County with the opportunity to do something on behalf of all the children in Halifax County. And we're in the room where they work. And so this third issue really is, are they doing their jobs on behalf of our children and their education in Halifax County? Okay. So I'm going to bring now to the podium my friend, my leader, Becky Copeland, chair of the Coalition of Economic, chair of the Coalition for Education and Economic Security.
Thank you, John, and thank all of you for being here today to show us and remind the rest of the county that the education of our children here, all across Halifax County, it is important to us. As John has already referred to, the complaint that we, the coalition, the NAACP branch, our Halifax County branch, along with three parents in Halifax County, we filed a claim against the Halifax County Commissioners on yesterday. And people may wonder, why did we file this claim against Halifax County Commissioners? The reason for the claim is because all of our children here in Halifax County, they have a constitutional right to a sound basic education. Some might ask why the county commissioners and not the school system. It is because our county commissioners, as John Ford stated, they are the one administrative body that can change the structure of our current districts. We are operated in a county of less than 7,000 students. Our commissioners are supporting financially three districts, three school systems. And it doesn't take Einstein's to figure out that logistically that does not make sense. So we have been before our commissioners here. We have presented, we have pleaded with our commissioners. Our coalition, we've hosted educational forums where we invited all school systems within the county to come out and have conversations about education in Halifax County. We've just done a variety of things. We've exercised our political rights here in the county to try to bring change. Our political system has failed us. And every day that our children are waking up in this county, they are still sent out to schools that are very inadequate. They are not meeting the constitutional right that they are entitled to. Our commissioner's response to that is as if it is a request that they can turn a deaf ear to. They act like they don't understand that they are responsible for the education of all students across the entire county here in Halifax. They act like some of our children are more entitled to a better education than others. And just by happenstance, that behavior that is displayed, that entitlement seems to be along racial lines. It is not fair and it is not equitable to all students in Halifax County. So the reason that we are here today to inform you of our litigation against the county commissioners, because they are the one who can stop the madness. Our education in Halifax County has derailed. We have media and outside forces that point the finger to one school system in particular. They always display negative behavior from a particular school system. They never speak to the cause of that behavior. And the whole time that all of these stories are running and we're being highlighted in the county in such a negative fashion, the real culprit is never being identified. And the real culprits meet in this room and discuss business that affect our children every monthly meeting, and they never have an iota of concern for all the students across the county. So that's why we have put this action in place, because when a county commissioner board will not answer to its people, then hopefully it will answer to the processes, the systems that are in place to force change. So I'm sure that all of you remember for a period of time some years back, we lived under the stigma of Judge Manning, who was willing to point out that in our county public system that they were creating academic genocide. And in that, what Judge Manning said about academic genocide being created in Halifax County, that much is true. The neglect on his part was to point the fingers to the real culprits, because the real culprits are in these seats right here. Every month, the culprits, the criminals that are holding back the opportunity for our children to be adequately educated in this county, they are in this boardroom here. And regardless of all of our efforts, they've not tried to offer any remedies. So we've had media that pronounced to us in Halifax County a new and different word. It speaks of obstreperous board members. So here again, undesirable behavior is highlighted, but nobody speaks to the real culprit. Nobody speaks the truth about what's causing these deficiencies in our county. So at this juncture, we felt that it was to do nothing is not an option. Somebody has to act. We've tried all of the processes. We've tried, within the community to bring resolve. None of that has helped. None of that has worked. Every year, even this year from our previous years in 2013, educational performance across the county is still declining. We cannot continue to sit and wait. Standing by and gazing will not answer the issues of today. It is time for us to take action. And this is why we are now involved in this lawsuit with the NAACP here in Halifax County, with these parents that is against our county commissioners because they failed to deliver sound basic educational opportunities to all of our children in Halifax County. As we move from this place, what I want to encourage you, and David will come, we've got packets for our media, we've got information that we can hand out to you that is credible information about what we're doing and why we're doing this, that shows a factual picture of what our educational forecast is and the reason for that here in Halifax County. We've got those packets of information that we want to give to you so that you don't have to rely on other sources that will use fear tactics. We know in the county here that's been a common thing. Mm-hmm. When we try to get sales tax at the voting polls, when we try to have our school system in the county have the opportunity to receive sales tax and supplemental tax funds. Even through some of our commissioners, they perpetuated the notions that the tax rates would be so high that you wouldn't be able to keep your property, you wouldn't be able to afford the property taxes. So they're using these scare tactics. You will read in some of our local media what is almost hate mail when we ask the commissioners here to just give to us what is rightfully ours. Mm-hmm. Well, it is the time and the hour that we are not any longer asking, but rather we are demanding. This type of educational change here in Halifax County. So some will ask about consolidation. They'll say that we'll have a loss of jobs, that we'll have a less quality education. Don't believe the lies that you are told. What we do know for sure here in Halifax County is the structures that we have in place right now is not working. And we do not suggest to you that consolidation will answer every question, but what we are telling you, it is an essential first step in the right direction to bring the educational reform here so that we can ensure that all the children here in Halifax County, whether you are in the most southern region or if you are in the most northern point, if you are to the western part or the eastern part of Halifax County, it is the responsibility of this Board of Commissioners right here to make sure that every one of our children have the opportunity for a sound and basic education. And this current structure is an impediment. It is a barrier. It prevents them from having access to opportunity. And so what we are saying today, with no exception and no excuses for our commissioners, it's time to change. It's time to at least start a path that we can reform education to make all of our children feel proud about the schools, where they don't have to come home and report stories of walking down hallways with sewage in the halls and mold and in the buildings and not have opportunities for recreation or athletic opportunities. It's time for equal treatment across Halifax County, and this board is responsible to make sure that that happens. So, I want to say to you that I'm glad that you're here today. And I want you to go back to your communities. And I want you to keep this information circulating and let the people know we won't take that it's always been like this any longer. We won't try to save a few jobs to at the expense of all of our children. Because when people say jobs will be lost, well, we have the same amount of students. But we're sending at least a minimum of $750,000 just on top-heavy administration, whereas in consolidation, there may be roles for all of these positions, but it could be placed in a manner that's more effective towards educating of our children, and funds are not being wasted through duplication, because that's what's happening. Mm-hmm. Why are we having to pay three central office supports for this duplication of costs that every system has? Why are we not combining these things to save that money so that we can then apply that money to educational services that all of our children need, and especially those that are at risk out in our county? That's where our highest at-risk students are.
That's right.
So, thank you for coming. I'm going to move out of this, away from this mic, and give opportunity for David Harvey, that we know he's the hardest working man in Halifax County, who are social justice. We are so happy, and I'm so happy that for all these years, and even before our coalition, he was somebody that was in the struggle to bring social change here.
Yes.
Thank you, and please greet for us David Harvey.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Becky, and thank you to all of you who came out today to get this message and to hear why we are here, where we are today. And Becky pretty much laid it out pretty well.
Yes.
While we're here. A lot of you have heard me say on many occasions, power concedes nothing without a demand.
That's right.
And will never concede anything without a demand.
That's right.
Never.
Never.
And I have said that over and over in this county. And we have tried all of the avenues that Madam Chair Becky laid out. We've tried. But we are where we are. We are where we are now. We're gonna let these commissioners now have to answer in the courtroom. Now they're gonna have to answer in the courtroom. They're gonna have to, in the courtroom, answer why they choose to support and maintain a system with three racially identifiable, unequal resource school districts, a board that obstructs every student's opportunity for constitutional complaint education. They're gonna have to answer in the courtroom now. They've been able to tell the people that support them almost anything.
That's right.
But now they're gonna have to answer in the courtroom. These racially segregated school districts, these commissioners have supported, has reinforced and perpetrated racial inferiority among black students. It's a vintage of the era of Jim Crow that we still live under here in Halifax County. Mm-hmm. It's time for all of that to come to an end.
That's right.
But we do now realize, because of all of the garbage that was put out in the 2014 election, one school system sending stuff all home from by their kids, anything they can to keep things the way it is.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's right.
that we have to take it to the courtroom. And the people that are responsible in the courtroom will be the people that sit around this table here. So finally, for the first time since I've been here, 10 years as the president of the NAACP, finally, we're getting some good news about education coming out of this boardroom. This is the first time. For the whole county. We're going to have those that don't support progressiveness. That there are actually people in Roanoke Rapids, in Halifax County, that do not support progressiveness.
That's right.
They don't support it. That's why they don't want change. They want to keep it the way it is. Because that's the way it's been for so long. And they want you to be okay with it. Just keep funding it. They want you to keep funding it. Because we've been funding it for all these years. We've been funding it. These commissioners are responsible for this. All the reason why I've said so many times to people in this county, you've got to learn something about the people you're casting a vote for.
That's right. Hello. That's right.
Learn something about their position on issues. Who cares if they're your neighbor, if they go to church with you?
That's right.
This is not about church. This is about our children
that's
in this county.
Right.
You got to learn something about these people. Because you have elected people that want to keep us in the Jim Crow era forever in Halifax County.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to turn to the court.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to have to answer to the court.
That's right. That's good.
The opponents and the people that don't support will be talking. You've been hearing it all along about what consolidation will bring. You're going to hear, they're going to be talking about, it's going to mean massive busing. You're going to hear that. Oh, if you consolidate, you're going to have massive busing. Well, let me just give you a little short story here on massive busing. Our children that lives in Hodgestown, in Southgate, in the Chalky Yawk area, all in the city limits of Roanoke Rapids, in Lincoln Heights, they're being bused all over the county right now.
That's
from
right.
A school that lives across the street from the house.
Yeah.
They've been bused all over the county. When have you ever heard anybody say anything about that? That's okay, because they're your children. They look just like you. So they're okay with that. We gotta fix this problem. We're gonna fix it in the courtroom. We're gonna fix it. We're not gonna depend on these people to have to make
that's
that decision.
Fine.
We're gonna fix this in the courtroom.
Mm-hmm.
So I say to you all, as we go forward, we need your support. We need you to still be behind CEES and behind the NAACP and behind these individual plaintiffs. Believe me when I tell you, we couldn't find better legal representation.
That's right.
Couldn't find it. We got people, one of the largest law firms in California, an international law firm. They could not believe what was going on in this county. Like most people can't. Most people can't.
Right.
I travel all over this country. They can't believe what's going on here. Because it's not normal, people.
That's right.
This is not normal. And I know some of you have heard me say this before. This is not a normal situation.
Right.
And we've been living like this for years. Our children have been disadvantaged for years. So we got the right legal team. We got a law firm out of Washington, D.C. that's part of the team. And our friends from the Center for Civil Rights who have been there with us through it all. So we're gonna take it to the courtroom. And we're gonna ask for your support as we go forward in the courtroom. And I'm gonna now turn it over to our leader at the state level, a man that I've been working with for the last 10 years. We came on the scene about the same time in North Carolina and have worked hand in hand throughout the years. And I can tell you, Madam Chair, Becky said I was the hardest working man in Halifax County. But let me tell you, when you work and you follow the lead of Reverend Dr. William Barber,
yes,
in this business, we are in the civil rights business. This ain't the let's make a friend business.
Come on.
We are in the civil rights business.
That's right.
And people in this county tend to forget that sometimes.
That's right.
We're about civil rights. And nobody, nobody in this state or in this country takes civil rights more serious and work as hard as our state president, Reverend Dr. William Barber.
I want you first to give yourselves a hand. And President Harvey, who's a friend, and I want to say this to the media, a volunteer, like I'm a volunteer. We do this work because it's deep in our hearts. And Ms. Becky Copeland, who's the chair, volunteer, and our political action chair, I want you to say something to you personally today and to this county. I want to bring you a message from the National NAACP. I sit on the national board as the chair of political action. And from the North Carolina State Conference of Branches, 150 youth and adult branches were the largest in the South and the second largest in the country. The Forward Together movement. So over 200 organizations that represent literally millions of people across this state. For instance, General Baptist State Convention is a part of the Forward Together movement. They have a 500,000 members of 1,500 churches, and I can go on down the line. But I say that to say something. I want to be clear. We emphatically and without apology and with no evasion or equivocation stand, Ms. Becky, with you, David, with you, the two organizations with the NAACP here, and say, when you touch these persons and organizations and the people and the children of Halifax County, you touch the entire structure of the NAACP. We put our full weight behind your efforts as this case goes forward, and as you are the three plaintiffs, and to the parents, we stand with you, all of our structure, our lawyers, and our support. I also want the media to make clear that of the diversity in this room, the support for this effort, black and white, standing together against modern-day systemic racism. And this is what racism is about. It's not about just a flag, even though a flag shouldn't be up. It's not just about somebody calling you the N-word. It's about, they may never say the N-word. But it's the systemic, institutionalized, statistical discrimination that can be measured and tested in the court. That's what racism is about. And make sure the word goes out that you can't say it's not a racial issue if folk can find one or two black people to support what they're doing. I'm going to say that again. Just because one or two black people support the three systems does not mean it's not a racial issue.
That's right.
You know, you can always find one or two that are stand against President Obama. I saw one the other night on TV. He said all the problems the black community have to deal with immorality. Black folk are immoral and breakdown of the family. And you can always find somebody that wants to stay in slavery.
Yes.
I mean, and that's not just mine, that's Bible.
That's true.
There were those who wanted to stay in Egypt.
That's true.
You prove racism by looking at the systemic facts and discrimination that's going on over against what the law. We are a land of laws. We live under God, and we live in the law.
That's right.
And so the state of North Carolina is failing our students.
Yes.
We are now, especially this current legislation, they cut so much money out of public education that we are now lower than Mississippi in per capita spending. And counties, particularly east of 95, are failing our students. Do you know that even in the federal courts in eastern North Carolina, there has never been an African American? Richard Byrd, a senator, for instance, has blocked a qualified African American woman, which means in the eastern part of the state, the federal courts look like the civil rights era never happened. And all over the eastern part counties, we're fighting in a number of counties, Duplin County, we're out here in Halifax, in Wayne County, we're fighting down in Lenoir County. These county commissioners and boards of education that live as though and vote as though they are locked in a time warp.
That's right.
And they often think, Brother Harvey, nobody's gonna come down to Halifax. No, it's not New York City. It's not Washington, D.C. It's not Atlanta. It's not Birmingham. It's not Columbia, South Carolina. Well, guess what? We've come to Halifax. And when necessary, we're going to move to the other counties. That's the other presidents here. Because our children are the most precious gift we have. And even the Bible says that to offend the little one, it would be better to tie a millstone around your neck and be thrown into the sea than to offend one of the little ones. Now, let me say a few things and we'll take questions. Racial and class segregation in our public schools is morally indefensible. You can't defend it.
That's right.
You can't defend it. You can't find scripture religiously to defend it. It's just wrong.
That's right. It's wrong.
It's constitutionally inconsistent because it violates the principle of equal protection under the law. And it violates the principle laid down in our state constitution in 1868 by two preachers. One was black, one was white. J.W. Hood, who became the bishop of the AME Zion Church, the president of Livingstone College and the first assistant superintendent of schools in North Carolina and the founder of Fayetteville State University. That was one preacher. And the other was Charles Ashley, who was a white congregation. They came together and wrote the language in North Carolina's Constitution after the Civil War. It's in Article 1 of the Constitution. It's not in Article 2, 3, 4. It's in the first articles of our Constitution that says that every person has a right to public education. And the qualification of that is a sound, basic quality of public education. Equal protection under the law was put in our Constitution in 1868. The Constitution says that you cannot take public money and spend it anywhere but on public schools. That's why we're still fighting another issue here. So it's constitutionally inconsistent. And it's economically insane.
Yes.
It make any sense to have three in a county this small. This is not Los Angeles, California. This is not New York with all of its boroughs, right? This is Halifax. You get on the road and drive through it like that. This is Halifax. This is the home of Ella Baker. This is Halifax. You don't have to take a subway. What's the towns in Halifax? What's the towns?
Roanoke Rapids,
Scotland Neck, Enfield. You don't have to take, you can hit all of them real quick and get a soda and a nap. Come on, y'all. This is Halifax. And it makes, the reporter laughed, it doesn't make any sense. You have three superintendents. Three offices. three assistant superintendents, three bus system, for the same chairman, as grandma would say, children.
And the buses running each other.
Running each other, passing each other on the same highway. It's economically insane. But not only that, in 1909, when NAACP was formed, one of the major issues was we would fight for access to public education that was not segregated. It took us 45 years to win that battle, 1954. This should have all been dealt with 61 years ago. This county is 61 years behind history. And Thurgood Marshall argued before the Supreme Court that not only does segregation hurt black children, it hurts white children. You can't even recruit businesses to a county that has three. Because business people... It hurts everybody. Now, the Charles Hamilton Houston Institute, David, and the Brennan Center. Maybe you all can check this out. I said there are two major issues that are negatively impacting America's public school system today. Resegregation and high poverty.
Yes.
And where you have one, you have the other.
That's right.
Where you have one, you have the other. And here you have all of it. And it says that if America would deal with resegregated, high poverty schools, you would see a tremendous increase in educational success. Because when you segregate bodies, you also segregate budgets, and you segregate teacher quality, and you segregate school building quality, and you segregate curriculum. It was never just about sitting beside a black person and a white person sitting beside each other. That's wrong enough in itself because that's not the real world. But when you segregate and you isolate, you also segregate the politics. Because the folk who, if a county commissioner is in a particular district and his district is segregated, then he doesn't have any obligation to vote or to care for all of the students. Make it so they pay a price if they hurt any student. Segregation and isolation undermines that political price that you pay. And it allows them to vote because they're not voting their own constituency's interest. That's what segregation does. That's what resegregation does. Now, know this, lastly. The Constitution says that we have a right. Every student has to have a sufficient ability to read, to write, to speak, fundamental knowledge of geography, history, basic economics, and sufficient academic and vocational skills. That is provided under what it means to have a constitutional education. This is what this court case will examine. In Halifax County, there are three separate school districts, and it serves fewer than 7,000 students. 7,000. Wake County has over 100,000 children. Charlotte Mecklenburg is a billion-dollar school system, and they don't have three. Yeah, goes on to say the population of Halifax is 40.3% white and 53% black. But when you look at the population of Halifax County Public Schools, the population is 85% black and 4% white. WCS student population is 94% black and 4% white, but the Roanoke Rapids is 26% black and 65% white. So you virtually have two school systems in one county that pretty much look like Brown versus Board of Education in 1954 never happened. And lastly, Lastly, we can take questions. The black school districts, this is the fact sheets, are consistently lower than those of the students in the Roanoke Rapid School System. The black school districts experience a higher rate of suspension. The black school districts experience a higher rate of dropout. The quality of educational resources, facilities, teachers, learning materials, curriculum provided to students in the black, predominantly black school systems in one county are well below. In the same county, you have students being treated fundamentally different. And it's not because our students are not well behaved. And it sure is not because they can't learn. Now, there are some people, sometimes even black people, that will say, well, if you just work hard, it doesn't matter what school you go to. I was going to be real deep, but I'm going to confess. I used to hustle pool when I was young. My daddy was a preacher, but he didn't know nothing about all this. And one of the ways you hustle somebody is you get them to play your game. And you come up with trick shots. When you play pool, you can tilt the table up on one end. And somebody might be able to make that shot, even with the table tilted up like this. Even though it's harder and it's uphill, somebody can make that shot. But here's the problem with that, as one of my professors used to say. That's not how you play pool. Just because a student comes out of these predominantly black schools valedictorian, that does not mean that the table being tilted up and them having to face the bad curriculums and the lower amount of resources is the right way you're supposed to be educated. Education is supposed to be equal for all. And anything less than that is a violation of our deepest moral values, our deepest constitutional values, and it makes no economic sense whatsoever. We stand with you.
So we do have a few minutes. Would anyone like to ask a comment at this time? Please go ahead, Alex.
Does the timing of the lawsuit have anything to do with the state board's decision to intervene further in the Halifax Board of Education?
No. Yeah. I can answer that question.
No, it does not. I have absolutely nothing to do with the state board decision with the Halifax County School System. If there was anything that this, with the timing of the lawsuit, it probably should have been not long after Brown in 1954.
If I may also add to that, the timing of the state intervention, if we tell that story correctly, the state has been here since 2009.
Yes.
If you want to speak to the most recent media coverage, speak to the fact that DPI was at our county system with the support of all of its expertise, with millions of dollars of funding, and was not able to improve our school achievement rankings by even 1%. So for folks like me who live here in Halifax County and love here in Halifax County, when I mentioned earlier about Judge Manning saying the academic genocide, the truth is the turnaround plan through DPI was the attempt to cover the bodies.
Yes.
It was not a turnaround plan. It was an attempt to cover the truth about what's happening here in Halifax County. And when DPI could not move the needle with regard to educational improvement, then it turned its attack to our local school board. And now it's trying to point a finger of blame to them not following their guidance, when that is totally not the case. And for a local, apart from my chair of CEES, from a personal note, let me say, I take that very offensively. So when we want to talk about the state intervention, pretty much what they recently announced to the media is not anything different than what they've been doing since 2009. But we don't have outcomes that suggest that your presence made a difference. Then you start looking for a scapegoat. And that's what happened. Tell the truth about DPI and Halifax County. You want to hear both sides. You listen to theirs, and then you come over here. Because what I don't like in this society, we have statistics that will qualify everything that's being said up here today, and we keep quoting statistics, and we keep using people to point fingers at, and nobody ever tells the truth about why this continues. So stop calling our people numbers. They are people. They have names. They are our children. They are our parents. They are our school leaders. They are our school board. This is our county. And we are severely offended by the negative attacks that come across the media in an effort to deliberately keep the truth about the failure of that DPI intervention hidden away from its public, because it did not address what we are saying today. The root cause of the failure in Halifax County education is that we are perpetuating this insanity that Reverend Barber just spoke about. It's insane to have less than 7,000 students and 3 central offices to support them when you have larger counties with more faculty than we have students in one district.
First of all, I'm sitting here thinking about Apollos and Priscilla in the Bible. We need to just make them the spokesperson. But first of all, know this, media. North Carolina has been failing ever since the Leandro case proved in 1999. Now, it wasn't even about race. This was about just poverty. It said basically that the state of North Carolina was the state of North Carolina, and it's not about partisanism either. The state of North Carolina was failing poor students in poor county by not providing a sound basic quality education.
That's right.
That's when you get the mandate decision. NAACP was a part of that as well, statewide. But we also have found now is that there's been more of an attempt to not fulfill what Leandro said.
That's right.
And to cover it up.
Exactly.
If you owe the money, if you owe $20, as long as the state has owed millions to poor students, you'd be locked up. But the other part of that is, and we should have learned this by now, they keep wanting to try to fix the system, but hold on to enough separate but equal to make some people happy.
Yes.
But separate but equal doesn't work. It never has, and never will. And so that's part of the struggle in the midst of this, as you raised with even state board. And now you have not just an attempt to cover, because Democrats and Republicans have blame in this, but now you have a situation where you have a group of extremists, who I don't call Democrat or Republican, they're just extreme, and they're just wanting to tear it all apart. They don't want to pass a budget, they won't field teachers, they cut money, they're lying to black folk and poor folk, saying we'll give you a voucher for $4,000 to go to private school, knowing that the average private school is $20,000. It's all an attempt. It flows out of a Koch brother mentality.
Yeah.
See, Freddie Koch, David Koch, Jocko's daddy, called for the impeachment of Earl Warren and the impeachment of Eisenhower when the Warren Court, May 17, 1954, decided the Brown case. We cannot act as though Brown happened and everybody was happy. Right here in North Carolina, I, Beverly Lake, went back to the Supreme Court after Brown had been passed and engaged in what we call Brown 2. Brown 2 is where they added the language with all deliberate speed. You can't be deliberate and speedy, which meant that states and counties didn't have to immediately desegregate, which is how places like Halifax were able to hold on all these years. So in the media, this is, you can't understand it in a vacuum. You have to understand the history. And what people have continued to try to do is rather than deal with it and say, and just repent and confess, we've got segregated high poverty schools. And we're gonna deal with this resegregation and the high poverty as one thing. It's like people trying to say, is it race or class? It is. It's race and class. And if you don't hold the two together, and you know, and anybody that will look at the statistics know good and well, you see it, the two schools, I mean, you know, if it wasn't hurting black and poor students and poor people, poor whites could get caught up in it, it wouldn't exist. You wouldn't have three systems in an affluent community that were predominantly white. You're just not gonna happen. It's not gonna happen. It happens when they think it's happening to people who will not rise up or to people who can't afford to fight legally. Well, thanks be to God that God always has a ram in the bush.
I'll take, we'll take time for just two more questions. Is there another one?
This question is for Ms. Copeland. Ms. Copeland, why do you think it has taken so long for this suit to come to fruition? And what is ultimately after the consolidation, what do you think should happen?
Thank you. For us, it has taken this time because we wanted to really test the hearts of the people, the hearts and the competence of the people here in the county. So we wanted to work within our community on the hopes that through community conversations here again, like presenting information to our commissioners here, factual, credible source information to our commissioners here, we were hoping that we could bring change to our educational deficiencies through just local effort. So we've exhausted all of our efforts. And here again to mention, back to the point of the state intervention, we even had, our coalition had a meeting where the state superintendent came down and talked with us as a coalition, along with the DPI directors, the leadership of DPI that was here in the county. And those were the questions that we were trying to find. Our effort was, tell us what the game plan is. What is the plans for sustainability? What are the barriers? I mean, we were trying to figure out because, as you know, they never gave our community in the county like an insight. They never even educated our community about what their intervention looked like. They never presented up front what a game plan was. So you don't know what the target is. And so we brought our state superintendent down to meet with us and just try to figure out what things that we can do to help Eva in that effort. You know, we want to share responsibilities here. We want to see what things that we can do in collaborations with our Halifax County Public School District, with our Weldon City School, with our Ronald Rapid School. So then we host the Educational Summit. So we constantly present to our commissioners. We've done so many things. Every other effort, we've gone through the political process. Every effort that could have brought us change has failed because here again, the tactics that are put out to just try and keep this current structure that is so imbalanced and so unfair. Mm-hmm. Everything works to try to maintain, keep this structure propped up. So that's what brings us to this place for this action.
Please, to the media, you said something earlier, and I like to say this to all our branches, please get this package.
Yes.
And because, as she said, it amazes me, we see it all the time on the state level. For instance, we did a Tomorrow Monday movement. We had all of these issues. And it's this group, I won't even call their name, and they can go to the media and say, what they're talking about is going to cost another $10 billion. And I tell the media, come back and ask us so we can prove that they're lying.
That's right.
Don't print this stuff.
That's right.
Just because people, that this is fact. These are from law, this is legal. These are documents produced by the lawyers. You know, I'm not saying the lawyers always tell the truth, because they don't. You know, and you don't either. Always tell. But the point is, there's something, this is DPI's number. These aren't numbers that Ms. Copeland and David got back in the room and said, let's come up with some stuff to make it. The numbers are the numbers. They're independent numbers. That's what you deal with in court, and that's why it's important to get it. You try politically and all of that, but you have to get it under the microscope of the Constitution and in the context of the court where people can be cross-examined. And examine, because that's a different kind of truth that comes out there, as opposed to what happens when people are sitting behind desks in a political meeting.
And to answer, that's exactly right. I mean, we pull credible information, put back together and package, just try to help to ease that learning curve for our commissioners even. But to the B part of your question here, with regard to consolidation, that we don't want anybody to think that that consolidation is a magic pill, it's not a silver bullet.
Right.
But it is a necessary first step, because it is tried and proven that the structure that we have right now does not work. Even with the millions of dollars and the extra assistance that DPI brought with it, it didn't have the ability to improve educational performance ranking from by one point. We are still 115. And while we are spending time attacking the victims here,
right,
the culprits are sitting back perpetuating this insanity.
Mm.
So that is what we don't offer. Consolidation is a start. It's got to be looked at. We even had these commissioners paid over $100,000 for an evergreen study. And it was commented through the people who conducted that study that consolidation is a no-brainer. That's what the study suggests. Then our coalition just pulled out a few baby steps in the Evergreen study recommendations, just a few baby steps that they said would save this county $10 million just by taking those small steps, not even enacting the whole plan.
Oh, wow.
Our county commissioners have not to date acted on one recommendation from that study, not the first one. After wasting $120,000 of tax dollars that could have been assigned to one of our classrooms to help our students. That's the wasteful spending that's occurring in this county. We are building facilities, new facilities, in one part of the county when old dilapidated facilities are existing in other areas of the county. And then some of the buildings that were the facilities that we have, they're not even occupied completely. I mean, there are empty buildings that are still waiting that can be useful, but we are spending millions to build new buildings for one district. So
that's
you can
right.
never come up with a formalized plan that can actually correct our educational issues, because the foundation is just so wrong.
That's right.
All right, I said we would take one more question. Is there one more? If not, I'd like to ask Miss Allen if you would come forward. Reverend Barber whispered in my ear that you would lead us in an inspirational song. Miss Allen is also a former school teacher. All right.
I can't say that happy to be here in one sense, but then again in another. Because we have a saying in the NAACP that you've heard on the big screen. Now, what do? When our children are under attack, we fight, we fight, we fight. And so one of the songs that we use in the protest is a song that has a rich history in civil rights movements called Hold On, Keep Your Eyes on the Prize, Hold On. And if you know it, I want you to sing that along with me, okay? Hold on, hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on, hold on, hold on, keep your eyes on the prize, hold on. Well, here's one thing I know we did wrong. Stay in the wilderness a little too long. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on. But here's one thing I know we did right. We started to fight for our children's right. Yeah. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on. Hold on, hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on. There's one chain I know man can stand. That's the chain of hand in hand. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. Keep your eyes on the prize. Hold on. Hold on.
Go on to Facebook, those of you who have Facebook, and look up the NAACP Halifax County, and you'll be able to, and like us there, and you'll be able to follow the progress of our case. Thank you very much.
Yes, yes.